Yes. Once again, we come right there where you are, to your home, with Open Talk. Remember, Open Talk is a program that we bring to you every Wednesday from 8:15 on television, and it is educative, informative, corrective, and is there anything like rebukative? Rebukative. I'm just talking about what the Bible says. We rebuke, we teach, we exalt, we instruct, all that, to bring you information and to talk freely, just to feel free. And I'm so glad that you have followed us and you've been with us on the social media. May the Lord richly bless you. I pray that even tonight you will not miss what God has for you. Remember, Open Talk's foundation is on the Word of God. Our common denominator is the Word of God, and that's why we come to you. And we have some guests. Joyce and I have some guests, but before I introduce the guests, let me ask Joyce to say jumbo tonight, and then I will introduce the guests tonight. Come on, Joyce.
And jumbo, and welcome to Open Talk. And it is our prayer that during this Open Talk, as we talk to our guests, that you, our viewer, will be blessed, and you will receive a word from, you know, our speakers, from the Lord. You'll be encouraged, and something will spark in your life. A word will be speaking, will spark in your life, that will cause you to take the next steps in your life. But we want to thank you so much for all you've been part of us, encouraging us, sending us messages, and telling us that this talk is helpful to you. And I know tonight is not an exception. You will be blessed. Karibuni sana.
Thank you so very much, Joyce. Once again, thank you for allowing us to come to your home, or to come to your hotel room, or to come into your phone. Can you imagine? We are inside your phone, and we are talking to you. Thank you so very much. I pray that you will hear the voice of God tonight as we talk together. Our guests tonight are not visitors to this program. They've been with us severally, and they've been a blessing. And this is Bishop Peter and Reverend Faith Ndungu of the Overcoming Faith Church on Thika Road at the Blessing House. On Thika Road at the Blessing House.
Blessed House.
Blessed House. The house is blessed, so it germinates blessings.
The blessing.
The Blessed House, that's where you receive your blessings. And they are the founders of the Overcoming Faith, and they're good friends of ours. And I was thinking, what made us good friends? And then I realized, I remembered what my English teacher used to say when we were teaching as English: birds of a feather flock together. And I started looking for our common denominator. Of course, our common denominator is the Word of God. The Word of God, the fear of God, and faith, and the respect of God, and integrity. And then in the social life, God brought us together. So I want to say welcome to the program tonight. Before I tell you what we are going to discuss on, let me ask Faith to bring her greetings. Say jumbo to the viewers.
Jumbo, our viewers. This evening, it is good to come to you again, as Bishop has said, to your phone, to your home, to your car, anywhere you are watching us from. I am happy to come and share with you, and I believe there is a word for you from the Lord. Amen.
Thank you so much, Reverend. And Bishop Peter.
Wow, thank you, Bishop Mark. What a joy to be back here and be able to impact the life of somebody. Like Bishop has said, we are so delighted to be here in the Open Talk, and we enjoy this program for one reason, that we just talk and allow God to take over the program, minister to his people, and so many lives have been impacted through this program. So we are so delighted that Bishop Mark thought about this, and now so many lives are being reached out there. And I want to say to you, that is listening or watching, wherever you are, you know, tag your friends, invite your friends, call somebody, tell them this is where to be for the next, you know, several minutes. And I have no doubt something good is going to happen in your life tonight.
Thank you so very much. So viewers, you're in for a good time. You know, life is a story, and everybody tells their story by their lives. And according to the Word of God in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5 and 6, God says that before you were conceived in your mother's womb, before I formed you, I knew you. I ordained you, I called you and ordained you to be a prophet. So you are, our lives are orchestrated by Jehovah. Mm-hmm. And God, who does not live in time and lives outside time, sees our lives from outside time and sees the connections that he has prepared for us. So God knew that you would be watching this program tonight. It is not by accident. Don't say you are just flipping through. No, no, no. It's by the divine plan of God. And Bishop Peter is and Reverend Faith are pastors, and they are doing a great job pastoring the church and raising up children. But you and I know we did not all start there. There is where we started. So the program tonight is, I would like us to get their story and what they have gone through. I do not know what you may be going through, but I want you to know that in this process of time, you will get to know what Bishop Peter has gone through, what Faith has gone through, and how God has come into their situations at the lowest level, at the lowest point of their lives, and rescued them and established them upon the rock. And this God never changes. He will do the same to you. So please welcome and just participate with us. Talk to us. Talk. You talk, I talk. We hear one another. So you talk. So please talk to us and let us communicate with one another. So I think I will come to you, Bishop, and say, okay, now that you have been on the program, we've introduced you as the pastor, senior pastor, overcoming Faith and having married Faith. You are a man of faith in every area. There's faith in your kitchen, faith in your bed, faith in every. Every area of life. Tell us your story. Where were you born? How did you grow up? And just some little story background.
Yeah. Thank you, Bishop. And we can talk about faith everywhere, but it did not start with faith. Mm-hmm. It's a long story. And everybody, as you're growing up, like Bishop opened and saying, God said, I knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. I chose you. So it's God has our destiny, only that he does not reveal unto us from the beginning to the end. For him, he has already seen it from the end, you know, beginning to the end. But for us, it kind of going, you know, goes and unfolds every day, every year. And we see faces sometimes we never thought we would be seeing in our lives. So where I come from, Muranga, that's my roots, my origin, a place called Mariaine, that's in Kandara, a very famous village because I come from there. Mariaine means the marshy waters, a place of marshy waters and all that. And that's where I grew up and went to school there, of course with a lot of challenges, like so many, you know, those people growing up there. And I remember going to school with a lot of challenges, always being sent home because of 50 shillings, because of 20 shillings, and our mother would always go begging the headmaster, please allow my child, I'll come back. Of course, this time we didn't have lunch for so long in school, you know, for many, many years we didn't have lunch. So it was kind of painful. We enjoyed it. I don't know whether we enjoyed it or endured it. But what I can say is that by the grace of God, we grew up there together with my siblings. We are eight of us. And so it was a big family. My father used to be a police officer. So he was gone. He would see him like three times in a year. And my mother was always taking care of us, bringing us up, going to the farm, and hiring some little farms and growing vegetables and doma, guashe, all those kind of things. And she worked very hard to make sure that we were well provided for. My dad has gone to be with the Lord, but our mother is still there, and she's a strong woman in the faith. And she took us to church, to the village church, which was an Anglican church then. And there we kind of began to grow in our faith. And before I went to high school, I gave my life to the Lord. I still remember it was in December before I went to Form 1 the next January. I don't know whether I was afraid of high school or something, but I decided I want to give my life to Christ. We had gone to Nyeri for a youth camp, and that's where the Lord called me. And from that time, I got very passionate, you know, serving the Lord as a young man, walking for hours, going from village to village. I didn't wait. You know, some people wait for 2-5 years to grow. I didn't wait for to grow. So I would stand. I remember my first crusade. I stood and I preached the gospel. That was way back in 1986. And I preached the gospel, and one mzee came after listening to my stories. I didn't even know the Bible. I'm not even sure I was carrying any Bible, but I had one microphone. You remember those Ahuja speakers, the horn speakers, which would always compete with the preacher, because you're preaching here and it's always going like, ooh, ah, hey, oh, it never stops.
Yeah.
And then somehow this man came, his name I'll never forget, because that was my first convert, and his name was Kangara, and he said, I want to give my life to Jesus. He was staggering and he was drunk. He had smoked bangi, marijuana. He had a rope in his pocket, and he had beaten his wife. So this man was loaded, you know. And he came and knelt down and he said, the Jesus you're talking about is what I want. And I asked him, you know, what do you want? He said, I beat my wife. I actually beat my wife this morning. I have a rope in my pocket. He removed a rope. I was going to commit suicide. I have marijuana. He was smoking bangi and he was drunk. But to cut the short story long, this man gave his life to Christ, and later on, you know, he grew up in the faith, and he became a church elder. And I believe he's still alive today. You know, after that, he would actually help me with a bike to go and preach the gospel. So I would walk for an hour to go and borrow his bike, and then go to some places in Makuyu, preach the gospel, return the bike, then walk back home for another 1 hour, you know, and all that. So my journey has been exciting. And then I went to the police, and because I told you my father was a police officer, so kind of he introduced me to go to the police college. That was another tough journey. The training there, I know, Bishop, you have not been there, but
no, I've never been there.
So many people ran away in the police college because it is tough. And for the short time we were there, the training was tough, but I decided I am tougher than this. I can endure this. I have gone through so much, and I can endure this. So I went to the police, trained, and then I was supposed to be posted in Kisumu, you know, but then somebody helped me to come near a home, and I was posted in Githumu. She happens to come from Githumu. The Lord knew. That time I did not know. You know. So me and her late dad, we were good friends in that village, and they used to be very excited to see a police officer who is born again, not only born again, but preaching the gospel. And I called for crusades and everybody will come, not just to hear the gospel, but to hear a police officer who is preaching the gospel. And that would excite the whole village. So they would come, I would call for interdenominational meetings, they would come, and they want to hear this young man, a police officer, born again. Are you sure he doesn't take bribes? Are you sure he doesn't do all these things that we hear and all that? Yeah, even my colleagues at the police station, they all knew I was born again. And even on Sunday, they did not allow me to work. I remember one Sunday I was supposed to be working, and I put on my uniform, went to work. And one man called Kamau, he came and told me, what are you doing here, Ndungu? You cannot be working on a Sunday. We know you're supposed to be in church. So go back to your house. I will stand for you, work for on your behalf, go and change, go back, go to church. And then when you come back in the afternoon, you can continue working. That's how serious I was, and they knew I was serious. So, well, I don't know where we are, but what I'm saying is that...
It's open talk.
It's open talk, anyway.
Yeah, this is open.
You know, and so I served in the police for quite some time, I think 6 years. I didn't stay for so long, but it was quite a tough journey. I remember my house in the police was a 10 by 10 room. And we were sharing, two of us. So this room was so tiny, so small. And the wall between me and my colleague was a curtain. You remember the blue bed sheets? Mm-hmm. We would put them there. So you have your room, I have my room there. And so all you could keep there, of course, we didn't have money to buy furniture, but the only two stools, a bed, and a stove. That was all I had between me and wealth. And so you cook here, and you eat here, and when you're going to bed, you don't have to stand. The bed is right here. So you only push back a little bit, and you're already in the bedroom. I call them a remote controlled, you know, houses, because everything is within reach. But by God's grace, I decided now I want to leave the police and go and do business as I continue to doing ministry.
Now, let's hold it there. You have now decided to leave the police and to go do business.
Yeah.
Let's pause a little bit and hear Faith's story.
Ah, yes. She has a story.
Give us some little story.
All right. Thank you again, Bishop Mark and Reverend Joyce, for this invitation. We feel honored to be in Open Talk. We love it. We love Deliverance Church International. We love One Accord. And we are happy to be here again. We believe you'll be blessed because that's why we came. And his story is quite dramatic. I'm not sure mine is very dramatic. But,
you are the drama queen.
I was born in the beautiful slopes of Moranga, a place called Gedhumu, as he has said, a tea growing area, a very beautiful area that had a lot of, you know, church and religion and Christianity and a lot of revival in those years. I was born in the 60s, and that's where I grew up, in a family of 10, and being the last. So by the time I came along, people had left home. Most of the people had left home. So I grew up a lot with my brother, the brother I follow, and always missed to have my sisters come back home, because it's like, you know, I always wanted them to come home. And my parents, of course, were advanced in age by the time I came along. And I think that I always look back and see it really marked the way I viewed myself, because I always used to see other kids' parents and they looked young, and I wondered, how come my parents are old? How come my father is old, you know? And my father was a businessman and also a farmer together with my mom. They were running a restaurant in the village, in the town. And basically that's really where I grew up. Either we were picking tea in the farm, or I'm working in the restaurant and running across the shopping center with clothes full of unga and carrying maka and anything that you can think about. You know, that is how we grew up in the village, doing everything, every kind of work that came along. And of course, growing up was not easy, because when you have many children that you're educating, my father loved education very much, but there were many of us in school. There would be somebody in A level and there's somebody in primary school. And so school fees was always an issue. And I always remember I used to be sent home for school fees a lot. But we didn't really have much money. But my father was he loved education very much. He was a disciplinarian and he was a very committed father. And I think that gave me a lot of confidence as I grew up, to know that I can pursue my dreams in life. And that does not mean that anything came easy. And so when I finished my high school and went to my A-levels, after that, I think now starting life, I went to teach as an untrained teacher. We used to be called useless teacher.
I can identify with that.
I'm sure you can identify with that.
I can identify with that.
And I was teaching in a private school in Thika that had these girls from rich families. Those days, private schools were not many. And so these girls are coming because either they have discipline issues, you know, something that made them be sent away from the public school, and they're in this school. And that was really tough. Because as we were teaching there, several of us that were teaching there, we didn't have money. So we used to look, you know, very haggard. We were poor teachers. You have, you know, to make one dress, it meant you have to buy a material, pay for it in 3 installments, and then use another 3 installments to make the dress. So you can imagine by the time you have a new dress and you are a teacher, and then you are walking to school in the dust. And so you get to school and you're full of dust. And these girls look at you and think, who is this, you know? And I used to wonder whether I would really ever come out of that kind of life. It was tough. And I remember a story that I like to tell. One of my colleagues, one of the young men, was living in a small house somewhere, and he couldn't even afford a chair. Personally, I was lucky because I would live with my sister's houses, in my sister's houses in Vika. But this young man could only afford a stone. He went and took a stone somewhere, maybe from a building construction site, and you know, a nine?
A nine by nine.
Nine by nine.
Yes.
And so when you go to his house, he tells you have a stone. So those are the kind of people that I taught with. And we really struggled with that. I taught for, I think, a year and a half. And then after that, I was admitted to college. And in those days, I think parents were also not maybe, either they didn't know how to even help the children pursue their career or even go to college. And so you are on your own. And so even though I had all these other siblings, I'm the one who used to run around, look for a job. I applied for many jobs, you know, and then look for a college for yourself. And one day I landed in, I landed on an advertisement for Kenya Technical Teachers College, KTTC. And so I got admitted, and so I came home, I said, I'm going to college. God is good that those colleges we were not paying then, and we would actually be given a small boom of 200 shillings.
Oh, you used to got 200?
200.
We used to get 20 shillings.
I think
that of course, in the 70s.
The years, that's right. Yeah. So by the 80s, we were getting 200 shillings. Mm-hmm. And so we had money to go to Gara and buy some second-hand clothes and at least look smart. You're also in the city, you know, and that is how I started my life. I went to KTTC, and then after that, I was posted to Vika Technical Institute and started teaching there. But by the time I was in my A-levels, that's when I received Christ as my Lord and Savior, and that turned my life around. I wasn't a good girl before then. I loved dancing.
I thought you're always a good girl.
Oh no, I wasn't a good girl except for
Jesus revelations
Christ
that come in life.
Confess to
her. I loved to have fun. I loved dancing very much, and that was really like, you know, I was so bound to that, and so I really used to resist giving my life to Christ. But when I was in my A levels, I gave my life to Christ. Mm-hmm. So by the time I went to teach in Trika Girls as an untrained teacher and go to college, at least I knew the Lord, and I was starting to grow in the Lord. And so we did a lot of ministry in KTTC. We would preach in the villages around Gigiri. You know, there used to be villages like Kodhuruma and New York Village and many other villages. And we did a lot of ministry. And I think that is where I started to grow in the faith and to know Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, Peter, you have decided to quit the police.
Yes.
You,
I was tired. It was very challenging working and serving in the police force. They used to tell us you have to work 25 hours a day.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the thugs and the criminals are working 24 hours, 24/7. So you have to go an extra hour to catch up with them.
You should have looked for me that time, because I had read a book on how to add 1 hour to your 24.
Oh, man. Too late. Anyway.
Yes.
So we worked so hard. I kept of course, it was very challenging also having my faith in Christ and all that, surrounded by so many people who are not believers. But I decided I will stand for what I believe, no matter the consequences. Yes, they are getting little monies here and there through dubious ways and manner always of life, but I decided the faith I talk about, the God I talk about, I want to demonstrate that. And I remember long, you know, fast tracking a bit, after I had left, maybe 10 or 15 years after, I met my former boss, who was Mr. Wambua, who was our OCS, and he could not recognize me. Here at Kasarani, then he was, I think he was the OCPD. And I tried to explain to him, I'm so and so, and then he stepped back like 3 steps and he said, Niwe, are you the one? And he said, Kweli Mungu yuko. If this is the Dungu I knew, serving, and I was very thin then. I don't want to say slim, but I was thin because you could not even get enough food. I remember my budget would only allow me to get a quarter of a kilo of meat once a month. At the end of the month, when you get your salary, because the salary was 1750, 1,750, then you can afford at least to spend 100 or so to buy a quarter of a kilo of meat. And you know, of course, the butchers or the people at the butchery, sometimes they can also be very cunning. Even within that quarter, they'll still hide a bone under there. So you go, you get home, of course they tie it with a roll, they used to tie the roll of newspapers.
Yeah.
So when you're carrying like you're carrying a whole 2 kilos of meat. It's only a quarter. That time you don't want visitors to entertain any guest in your house. So you go lock your door, make your ugali, and then when you open your meat and you want to cut it and cook, you realize half of it is bone. Mm. So maybe what you have there is a nail. But that's the only one we could afford for the whole month. So I was very thin, but I decided I'm going to quit. And I went to the OCS and I said, you know what? I feel God is calling me to do something different. I want to go do business as I do ministry. And I left. And then I went to Kikuyu. I rented a house in Kikuyu. My brother used to live in Kikuyu, so I used to visit him, my brother Steve. And he was doing business then. He had a shop there, and he would go to Gekomba and other places and buy stuff and all that. And he mentored me into doing some business. This time I'm coming in, I don't have any money. I actually had a loan that I had borrowed from the police circle of 25,000, which I bought a big radio and a few other things I wanted to buy. So I was still paying this loan, and I had a balance of about 12,000. So I went to the police circle and I told them, you know what, I don't want my guarantors to get into any problem. So I'll be paying you 1,000 every month. And I was faithful to pay the 1,000, that's a whole year, to clear the loan of 12,000. And I was able to finish that. And then I went to Gekomba. And you know, I think Gekomba has really helped so many people. You know, God bless Gekomba. Because I went to Gekomba and I started selling clothes, and I would get some, of course you go there with shoes, nice shoes, remove them, put on gumboots, ingia huko kwa matope, you know, do business. We used to buy the kabuti, the watchman coat, you know, they call it the watchman coat, the long coats with very big buttons. Then we would remove the buttons, put a nice zip, and then it will look like a nice jacket, and then cut it to a nice size, and then you fold it nicely. You buy it for like 150, you use 100 for repairs and cutting and putting a nice zip and all that, and then you go to the streets and you sell it for 350, you know, you make 100 or so. And that's a business I did, and then I realized, well, people in the offices are very busy. They don't have time to go and do shopping. I knew some people at NSSF building and those kind of places. So I would buy clothes and shoes from River Road and take it up to them. And I would make a few shillings here and there, collect Bibles. Those times they used to put the Bible covers, the leather. They used to call them leather. Those were not genuine leather. And cover the Bibles. I would collect them in Kikuyu, bring them to River Road, you know, and I'll be charged like 30 shillings per Bible. Take it back to them, and I'll charge them 50 shillings, and so I'm making my 20 shillings. So those, I don't know whether that's what people call hustling, but I know in Kenya, hustle sometimes can mean something different.
Yeah.
But I was just hustling anything, and I decided I cannot steal. I know people, I don't have money in my pocket, but I know somebody else has money. So I cannot steal from them. I am a believer. How do I get that money? I don't want to be corrupt. I have to be creative. Think about those small businesses I can do. Then, you know, I joined my brother in running this shop, and now we are growing. And then I could get by from Ruthuri some radio and some TV and all that. Later on, it became actually an electronic. Initially, it was for clothes. Later on, and this was interesting how it went to electronics, because I bought a radio and I would play some gospel music. Then somebody would pass by and ask, how much are you selling this radio? You think I would say, no, it's not for sale, it's for playing music. I decided, well, I can sell it and go. I know where to get another. I would say maybe 2,000 or 3,000, and then I know I'm getting 500 or 400 shillings, and then bring another one. Then somebody would come and ask, how much are you selling this radio? And then I would sell it. Then I realize I can bring two or three instead of just going and rushing and bringing one. And from that, we started bringing radio. Later on, they started asking for TV. Then we brought the TVs, and then we call it Victory Electronics. And in Kikuyu, there was no other, you know, electronics shop. That's one, the first one, and we did so well. We made some money. In about 2 years, I was able to buy a car out of this very humble, you know, backgrounds. And around that time, of course, now when you're settling down as a young man, you also think, how can you settle down and really settle down?
I was going to ask, all this time you are not married.
No, this time I'm not married, mm-hmm. because you're wondering, if I bring in somebody else, what are we going to do here? Because even for me, getting food for myself, it's a challenge. You know, getting my own clothes is a challenge. I remember, like, when I found my brother, he had a shop here at an ordination house, and you know, my brother Steve, and when I'm coming there, I visited him from the police. I had a belt that was totally worn out, and this belt, he looked at it. He was selling belts, so they are all, you know, everywhere, and he removed one of the belts and said, "Hey, far he wachana he toa he imekwisha." You know those belts you mm-hmm. wear until now? You have to look for another hole, because this one is finished, this one is torn, this one is finished. And he gave me a new belt. And what I'm saying is that God was gracious. I'm still a believer, yes, struggling. It doesn't mean believers don't struggle. Mm-hmm. But I think what keeps us going is the hope in Christ and trusting God, being faithful, keeping our values very close to us, that we value integrity, and trusting in God and faith in God. And along that time, I got married. You know, to cut the short story long. I got married, and a beautiful wife, not her, her name was Beatrice. We had met through a ministry that we were running called JEREC, Jesus Revival Crusaders. It was initially Kate Kangema evangelistic team, basically preaching around Muranga, but then we broadened it to reach other areas, Kiambu, Nairobi, Muranga, and other places. We used to hold the youth camps every April and August and then December, and go to different places. So around, you know, those, you know, places preaching the gospel, I met this beautiful lady called Beatrice. She was a teacher, high school teacher, teaching in Niteto girls in Nyeri, and we got married. So we had a beautiful, beautiful wedding here in Nairobi, and we were settling down. Life is good. God is blessing. We are serving God. This time now, I had become a pastor. So I'm pastoring a church. Initially, I was pastoring in Makuyu, living in Kikuyu. So I used of course, I'm not driving, so I would go from Kikuyu, and this time they didn't have the highway, you know, what do you call it?
The Thika.
Not the Thika, but the Western way, you know, going to Kikuyu. So we used to go through, Dagoretti, all the way Kawangware, coming down to, you know, Valley Road to town. So the bus would take even 2 hours to come to town. So I used to take a bus from Kikuyu, come to Nairobi, take another one to Thika, from Thika to Makuyu, from Makuyu to Mungedho, where the church was. But I'll be there by 8 o'clock in the morning. I think one of the things I have always been, I decided I have found what I've been looking for. The Lord has given me peace, then I'll serve him. I want to be faithful, I want to be committed. And from that time, I've never been late for church, and unless for a very, you know, serious, you know, reason. Now, where we are here, serving the Lord, Makuyu, then I came to Githurai. There was a small church that we had begun in Githurai. We were renting a place called Kongo's Farm, about 10, 12 people, and I decided now it's time to come to Githurai, and we started serving God there. And this church began to grow. We were renting.
Now, this time you are already married to.
Now I'm married to Beatrice, and we are serving the Lord together. It's exciting. And then within that time is the time that God gave us a car. Now we can even drive from Kikuyu to Githurai. I still remember when I first drove, there's somebody, I didn't have enough money to buy this car. So the person that I knew who was selling cars in the industrial area, he said, "I have a car here," and I went to them, I negotiated. I still remember it was 400,000. But the match I had was not even 200. But we agreed that I'll be paying you kidogo kidogo, little by little. Mm. So I went to industrial area. Of course, even this money I'm raising, the 200, I don't even have enough. So I talked to a few friends, and my wife also got a loan from her SACO, and we put all this money together. Somebody lent me 80,000, so I had very little money. And this man agreed graciously to give us the car. I had done driving, but I had not driven for so long, so I didn't even know. I was not even confident in driving. But I decided this is my miracle. I'm not leaving it in a, I still remember it was a Saturday afternoon. I'm not leaving this in industrial area. I'll drive all the way to Kikuyu. And I drove this car, I think probably using the same gear, or one gear, all the way to Kikuyu. And people are hooting, hey, get out, what's happening? And I said, no, I shut my windows, and I said, you don't know what's happening here. This is between me and God. And then the following day on Sunday, I decided I would drive all the way to Githurai. I woke up very early. Of course, that night I drove, I dreamt three times the car has been stolen. And then I go people through the window and realize the car. You know, some of those dreams you dream and you see it, it's real. I mean, you look at it and this must be it. The car has been stolen and you can see it driving off. But I think I was very anxious. I mean, I had never thought I would own a car. Mm. I mean, this is really, a new car, used in Japan, but new in Kenya. Mm. You know, it was a KEL or something like that. But then I drove, then coming to Westerns, I bump on somebody's bumper, but that did not deter me. I decided, well, I'll still make it to church. And I went all the way to Githurai. After church, I told the other people, I have a car here. The Lord has given me. Nobody, of course, even thought of a car then in Githurai. There was not even a road to get to the church. We'd park the car like quite far on the other side, then walk to church, because that time Githurai, the roads were very messy and all that. So, well, we dedicated the car. When we went to pray for the car, they even said, okay, we didn't think it was this kind of a car. We thought they are those cars, you know, they are cars called Arumekiai.
Shtua.
You know, yeah, Shtua. Yeah. You know, they used to call them Arumekiai. Arumekiai. You know, just push it so that it can. But this was a nice car God has given unto us. And from there, one day, now coming, you know, fast tracking a little bit, God is blessing us. We are serving the Lord. Of course, a very small church now has become the car for the ministry, because nobody else, including our overseer, then had a car. So everybody wanting to, if we have a guest, if we have a trip, if we want to go to Nyeri or to Nakuru or any place, this is the car. And I was faithful in offering this car for service and, you know, serving the Lord. And of course, for my business, because I used to buy the TVs and the radios from Ruthuri here and take them all the way to Kikuyu. Initially, I would use a mukokoteni, you know, the hard cut. I would buy from Ruthuri, they push it all the way to railways where the matatus to Kikuyu were, and I would pay like for two rows, two seats, and then put them there, load them there, and take them all. I remember one time we almost died because, you know, the Kenya bus services, the Kenya bus then, there were somebody, you know, the driver was negotiating a corner, and here we are. I am here, the guy pushing the mukokoteni. I'm following him very closely because this is a stock of about 50, 60,000. I have to keep my eye on it. Nobody can touch it. And I'm here looking like a bouncer, you know, watching on my property. And then this bus is negotiating a corner. He didn't realize there is a mukokoteni here. And so he came and, you know, bumped on this mukokoteni. I jumped up the pavement. The man was a little bit injured, but it was not so bad. Kamuliza uko sawa, tuendelee. He pushed it to railways, but now here I have a car. I can drive to Ruthuri, you know, load the stock and, you know, take it to Kikuyu. And then the tragedy happened. We were coming from church in 1998. Oh my goodness, 1998. You know, 1990. We are coming from church. We came from Githurai, that's why we were ministering. We went to Dandora. We had a sister church there. And we had a fundraiser, I still remember, for buying a tent. And then we are now driving home to Kikuyu in the evening, Sunday evening, around 7 o'clock. We are arriving home, and here we are, excited. The day has been great. And then about 100 meters before we arrived, we had just turned, made a turn, to now leave the highway or the main road to go to the, you know, the
feeder road.
Yeah, the feeder road. Now we can join the road to our place. And this man was driving now from Kikuyu, and he, you know, hit our car on the side where my wife was seated. This time we are expecting, she was expecting our first baby. She's 8 months pregnant, and both of them did not make it. I didn't even, you know, like fraction of a second. And then from there, the commotion, we are rushed. I don't even know who, even today, I don't know who took us to Nairobi Hospital, a good Samaritan, God bless them, wherever they are. And then they took us to Nairobi Hospital around 8:39, we are there. For me, I was not badly injured. And here they are, the doctors, I can see they are running up and down, they are wondering what to do. And then they came out, they started recording what I was going to say. They asked me one of the hardest questions of my life. They asked me, between the baby and the mother, who would you rather save? And I didn't know what to say. And maybe I thought, maybe if you try to save the mother, we can get another baby. But it was a very hard question for me. And I can see they were recording. And then after maybe 30 minutes, I was just lying on the floor, agonizing, in a lot of pain, and wondering, what is this? Where? What happened? Where were we? And all those kind of things. And so many questions I could not answer. And then here we are. They came back and said, we are sorry, they didn't make it. Mm. And that changed the whole story of my life.
Wow.
Just like that. Mm. And now calling my brother, my brother Steve lived in Thika, then he had moved from Kikuyu to Thika. He's living in Thika, they had to come at night. My sister, whoever, it became a big commotion around 11 midnight, we are still there. A lot of struggle, wondering now, where do we go from here? Is this real? You feel like you're in a dream, like this is not a reality. I mean, this, how can this be? Mm. And I started wondering, we are a good family. We are coming from church. We are serving God. I hear families in the neighborhood that are always fighting. God, why us? And not them, and not others who are families that are struggling and all those kind of things. But here we are, and God is gracious. Of course, for the next 2 years, I would say it was tough. Mm. I would say I had a time of depression that I felt like now life has no meaning. You know, let alone the insurance paid the car, I was about to get another car. Sometimes I would drive when I'm going to Kikuyu, and I'll be driving maybe 130, 140, and it's like I don't care. If anything happens to me, it's like life has lost meaning. Mm-hmm. What am I holding on to? I would get to our two-bedroom house, and I didn't even want to switch on the light. You know, I would just go and touch the walls. I have eaten wherever I came from. This time I'll maybe visit a friend. I don't want to leave and go back home. Because when you go back home, the house is speaking to you. Mm-hmm. You're feeling like, we were a family. We thought we are settling down. Now here we are, and I'm alone. Who am I? It's like I have lost identity. I'm not a youth. I'm not married. You know, I don't, mm-hmm. can't go back to the youth fellowship. Who am I even in all this, you know, scenario? And I would go back there. I don't want to switch on the light. Just get into the bed and sleep, crying, you know, wondering, all that. Of course, in the church, they would think, oh, our pastor is very strong. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember when I went back and one of the church elders said, wow, our pastor is very strong. He's back. And now he can come and preach. And this time I'm feeling like I would want to run away. Mm. I'm not here to preach. I wish somebody was here to minister to me, because I'm wounded. I'm a wounded soldier. I need help. I need support. But anyway, God's grace is sufficient. Mm. So I lost my entire family. And I really thank God for the people of God. They really prayed for me. Got a lot of support. Some of them would just come into my house, people like Bishop Gachie, my brother, you know, my brother Mogo, who is a husband to my you know, sister to my wife, my late wife. And they would come and pray. And this gave me the strength just to stand and rise again. And then I remember when Benny Hinn came to Kenya in 2000, and I attended the crusade. I was seated all the way back there. I mean, I could not even get to the front. It was too crowded. You remember at the place here, and I still remember seated all the way back there. I think we were with her, Is that right? If I can remember. And I think one of our children or something like that, and you're seated, and in that crusade during prayer, I felt something lift. And I felt, wow, all the pain I have had for 2 years, the burden, the oppression, is like something just left my life. And my life changed from that time. I felt now I can do it again.
Okay, now you know there's somebody listening there who could be going through that situation.
Yeah.
And that's the importance of our testimony.
Yeah.
That God lifted you up. You are in a meeting. You are not. This is not even what you are praying for.
Yeah.
You are going. You have gone there for just to hear God. And
yeah.
God just comes and lifts you.
I came to see the crusade. Yeah.
Yes, and yeah. lifted the burden.
Yeah.
The burden. Let's go back to faith. I'm sure you have a journey.
Yeah.
You have been in the. You are now teaching at the technical school and all that. Now you are doing a lot of missions. And then, so what happened? Tell us from there what happened.
Thank you, Bishop. And you know, as I'm listening to Bishop's testimony, and I know that testimony, but it always amazes me how God is able to heal and lift us up from, you know, the miry clay and the horrible pit of pain, and just make our lives beautiful, even when we feel like it's just ashes and there is nothing. And you know, of course, we are here together. That means we met at a certain point. He talked about Jerek. He talked about Jerek, which was an evangelistic ministry, and that is where we met. Because when I was in college in KTTC, as I said, that is where I met my first husband. We were both students there, and he was doing the technical courses. I was doing the business course, and. He's the one who used to be a member of the Jerek, and he would actually invite us before he left college, because he left before us. He actually invited us, because every weekend he would be out going somewhere for a mission, and we know he said one day, I know you people keep wondering where is this I go to, and he invited a few of us to go for a camp, and so when we went to Jerek, we started liking the idea of young people that actually come together to go to schools and colleges and preach the gospel and have holiday camps. And so, maybe the long story short, when I left college and went to teach in Thika, by then we had already become friends with him. His name was Tony. We had become good friends. And when we started teaching together, and that was like around 1990, that is when I joined him in Bika Technical, and we started planning that now we could get married. And by 1992, we actually got married in a church wedding. And by then I was going to Thika Christian Church. And so that is how my life started as far as marriage was concerned.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm no longer the young girl. I've now become a mother, I've become a wife. And we started doing life together and still serving God in the church together. And of course, life was not easy. Like everyone else, you know, you're starting out, and there are many challenges in as far as finances are concerned. But God blessed our marriage with two children. We got a girl, and then we got a boy, and so we continued to serve God together. But in 1998, he also passed on. This was due to the bombing of the U.S. Embassy here in Nairobi. And, you know, I must say that when we got married, he was also teaching. But then later on, God opened the door for him to work for the American Embassy. And of course, that was a high for us. You know, we have stopped being both of us teachers. We can at least look at better prospects in life. We are excited. That was 1990. Was it 93? Mm-hmm. I think it was 93. So it was soon, actually, like a year after we got married. And so we were excited. He's gotten a better job. We are going to live a better life. And we are going to at least, you know, do better, you know, things in a better way. And we're getting excited about that. But I get shocked today when I look back at that, because by the time he was joining, there were terrorists that were already planning. When I read the story of how these people planned the bombing, they were planning it from 93. So as he's joining, actually there's somebody planning their death But, you know, we don't know. Because, again, as Bishop has said, you know, we go through things and our lives unfolds before us. It's like a piece of paper, you know, that is folded, and we get to only see this flap here. And but you know, God knows the whole of it. And I look back and I say, you know, God knew all that all the while. We are celebrating. He's gotten a better job. I would come to Nairobi and visit him at the offices here. You know, it was just right close by, and it was exciting. And we would go take lunch, and we have these big dreams of how we are going to, you know, build up and how we're going to buy land and settle down. And we had big dreams, you know, of how we're going to do life. But in the meantime, we were still preaching in the Jerek. He was actually our chairman. And that is where I also met Peter. Because he used to preach to us. He was one of the people that would preach to us, as well as Tony. And he was a very interesting preacher. He had a lot of humor, and so, and we used to call him Kamau Police. That was the name we had given him, because we loved his preaching. And so, but I also had, of course, with Beatrice and everyone else. And so really there was nothing between us, and never dreamt of anything ever coming out of us. In any case, I was already taken, and you know, we were settled down. And so as we continued on, of course, 1998 came, August 7th, and my husband was one of the victims of the bombing. And so just like what he's describing, you know, the hopelessness came. And, you know, just the day of darkness, that from now on, I am not sure what my life is all about. And I think one of the greatest losses in life is the loss of a spouse. Because you were married, and you are Mrs. So-and-so, or you are husband to so-and-so. And now that status has changed. And so you start, you know, you start feeling like, who am I? When you go into a gathering, who am I? If people are calling for a couples meeting, am I supposed to go? You know, I used to go, so am I supposed to go for that? You know, when the family is gathering on Christmas, am I supposed to be part of them? And so people really go through a lot of pain, and I went through a lot of pain. I didn't know what to do with my children. They were young. My daughter was 3 years. My son was just 1 year, 3 months when the dad died. And so I was, it's like, I felt like I'd been thrown into the air and just dropped down. And it's like, okay, so where do I go from here? But I also must thank God for the care of friends. And church friends, I remember him and his wife Beatrice, and the sister and the others. He would really come to my house and encourage me and build me up. And the Jerek members and church members, of course, where I used to go to church, the pastors, and they really held my hand. And I would want to say, if you're going through that kind of a big pain, I think you don't want to stay away from the church family, or friends or family that would want to help you, you know, because you need them. You need them at that kind of a time. And so for me, it was a very, very difficult time. I suffered depression also. I became so thin, and I have always been slim. And I think that time I was actually thin, and I became thin. I remember one time my brother came to see me and said, I think he must have been sent from the family. Of course, he didn't tell me that, but said, how can we help you? Because you've really become so thin, and you look like you're disturbed. And of course, I didn't even know what to tell him. What I mean, whatever you're going through is too heavy to even be able to say, this is my need, or this is my problem. And you just starting to pick up your pieces. And so along the way is, you know, actually just 3 months after the bombing is when Beatrice now died in the road accident. And I remember the Jerek members came for me and said, Faith, if there is anybody we cannot leave behind when we're going to see Peter, it is you. Because I believe you are the only one who can make sense to him, you know, in whatever he's going through. And I remember we went to his house in Kikuyu, and we were told he hadn't talked for the 3 days after the accident. He hadn't talked. We went the third day. He hadn't talked to anybody. And so we found him and we started talking, and at least he could listen and feel like, I can listen to you. Because he could relate to me. And I must say, I think the fact that we could relate to what we had gone through is really what helped us to warm up to each other and start feeling like we can talk. Not even thinking marriage, especially for me, I'm not sure about him, but for me, marriage was out of the question. I remember some journalists that came to interview me in my house, you know, after my husband died, and they said, would you remarry? These are some America. I think either they were from America or from Britain. And I wondered, what's wrong with this wazungu? How can they even bring up the issue of marriage? I said, no, I can't get married. I belong to this family and I cannot even consider it, you know. I remember another friend of mine also who really stayed with me in my house all along, but then she had to go to Canada, and she has stayed with me in my house. Before she left, she said, Faith, I want to tell you that if God gives you somebody to marry, you should not hesitate. And I told her categorically, I cannot get married. And I know maybe I'm speaking to somebody who is
That. I identify with you because I've passed through that.
Yes.
And me, I told the church, don't talk to me about marriage. Don't even pray for me.
Yeah.
As far as marriage is concerned, don't pray for me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually a difficult situation.
Yeah.
And you could be watching this program, and that's what you're going through. That's why this program is here for you.
Mm-hmm.
So you can be able to hear what others have gone through. Whatever you are going through, there are people who have gone through, and God has seen them through.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what we're going to do, this is story, we cannot finish now. This, you have just now seen the pain, the cause of the pain, and the pain that the bishop and Reverend Faith that are going through before they ever met. You could identify with that. I identify with that. I went through. But in a moment, this coming program, the next program, we are going now to see, okay, how did you get rid of the pain? How did you deal with the pain?
Yeah.
And from the pain, what happened? And that way it shall unfold so that you may know how to deal with your pain. And or you right there where you are, you can sit patiently like Joyce and listen to this and identify with this situation of those who have gone through. My dream is that I will be able to get to you so that all those who have lost their loved ones, maybe you're a widow or a widower, you have lost a loved one and you are going through difficult, you don't know what to do, I will give you my number, you can call my number so that we can be able to come together and help one another. And let you know that this is not the end of the road. It does not mean that you are finished. Because remember we said, God is outside time. He looks at time. You and I are in time. But God is outside time. And that's why he brought Bishop Peter and Faith so that we can be able to go through this together. So I want to say, I think for now we will keep it there. Then this coming Wednesday, we can continue from there because our aim is to help somebody.
Amen.
That is why God allows us to go through some situations so we can be able to help somebody else.
Yeah.
But I want to say thank you so very much for the way you brought in your story. It's so powerful, it's so touching, and I pray that somebody's life is going to be touched.
Amen.
For our viewers, we want to say thank you so very much. May the Lord richly bless you. We'll see you this coming Wednesday. We'll be with the same guests will be there, and they will take us the next step from there. And also, we will be looking at the challenges that we face in a remarriage. The challenges that you may face in a remarriage, and not only challenges, but also the blessings. Because there are challenges and there are blessings. With that, may the Lord richly bless you. Thank you so much. We'll see you again in Open Talk this coming Wednesday. God bless you.